Hey there, Cape Cod. It's high noon on Wednesday. Time to get together for an episode of Life with Gwen. I think you guys are going to be pretty interested in what we're talking about today because I have some statistics here that show that plant-based eating is just taking off. And I keep getting more and more calls. You know, we still have those recipes for the people who want to grill, but I keep getting more and more calls about creative ways to make plant-based food. There are statistics from a plant-based website here talking about how the alternative milk market is booming, and also how we're seeing all kinds of growth, 20% growth of all categories for plant-based protein. I won't take up too much of our time talking numbers because, you know, we can always get those. And handily, I have this nice little spaghetti squash here that can double as a paper rest while I introduce today's guest. Hello and welcome. With us today is Dr. Miguel Prieto. He is a primary care physician in Bourne with Cape Cod Healthcare. And he is here because he's a big advocate of plant-based eating, but he also is someone who's made the decision to do that for himself. Welcome. Nice to see you. Thanks for coming.
Thank you for having me, Wen. This is very lovely.
Well, we met at a plant-based cooking class that you were doing at the Upper Cape Cod Yes. Regional Technical School in their beautiful new demonstration kitchen. And you were making some recipes there. But you're also talking about the fact that I forget how long it's been, but you yourself decided to eat plant-based. Tell me a little bit about that.
Right. The main thing happened when I've been reading medical studies about, you know, prolonging life and being people being healthier so they could achieve the goals that they want in life. And the more I read, the more I became interested. Then once one physician who's been very influential, Dr. Kumara Siddhartha, in our group, and he talked about health, plant-based diets and eating, and I looked into it. And the more I look into it, I saw evidence on the medical studies that was really hard to refute. And I decided to try it before I will tell my patients, you know, this is an alternative for you. And I can tell that the studies keep coming out. And it's very interesting. There was the CDC found that when you basically engage in three behaviors, number one, not smoking. Number two, having a healthy diet, just defined by eating at least 5 servings of fruits and or vegetables a day. And then number three, physical activity, just 21 minutes a day. If you do
21. Okay.
So look, if you engage in one of these three behaviors, your risk for death in the next 6 years goes down 40%. If you do two out of three, your risk for death goes down over 50%. And if you do all three, your risk for death goes down around 80% in the next 6 years. And that was, you know, accounted for age and everything. So
I'm going to start walking. I really am, because I want that extra 30 or 40%. So
it was quite an eye opening to see that. And then I started to see in a more biochemical level how certain enzymes actually perpetuate inflammation process and the damage that they can cause to your body. And I saw that the plant-based nutrition was actually an excellent way to achieve this. Mm-hmm. So they call it
to minimize inflammation?
To minimize the incidence of chronic diseases or reverse it.
So people who are, you know, already living with something, they can make it easier to live with? Is that basically?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Your body is amazing. It's so great. It has the capacity to regenerate. It will heal if we just let it heal. Mm-hmm. The problem is we just don't give it a break. And, you know, one of the things that I always comment, if you have the best photocopy machine in the world and you make a copy of a page, it looks pretty much identical. You can't really tell apart. But if you make a copy of the copy and you keep doing that 10,000 times, at the end, you will see a difference and you can tell them apart. And the reason I'm giving that metaphor is that your body repairs your cells, the DNA in your cells. And it's quite amazing. The DNA is coiled into chromosomes. And if you were to make a strand of DNA out of each cell, it would be about 6 feet tall. And you replace about 300 million cells a minute.
So Holy cow.
So talking about numbers, if you do the math, I mean.
And like how many, I don't know if this is a appropriate question, but how many cells do you have? Like when you're replacing 300 million a minute?
Well, we have trillions.
Oh, okay.
The trillions. But so the question here is, what is the breaking point or the overwhelming point in which your body is unable to make a faithful copy of the DNA? Making a mistake, because if you're juggling too many things at the same time, we haven't been able to find a number, but we've been able to find that if we lower the need to replace the cells, because you're not damaging them, you actually stay, quote unquote, younger.
So let me see if I understand this. Our bodies will find and replace damaged cells. And damaged cells are sometimes, it could be illness, but more often it has to do with our diet and what we're putting into our body, yes?
Right, so inflammation is actually a process we all have to repair damage done. And usually it's done by a germ, it's done by a virus, it's done by toxins. And your body removes the offending agent and then tries to repair the cells. By removing the offending agent, it releases all these free radicals that cause oxidation. Basically, it's just like if you were rusting.
From the inside.
From the inside. That's why we talk about antioxidants. They keep you from rusting. Slows down that process. So by doing that, we prevent the collateral damage to normal cells and to the DNA. And the DNA in the mitochondria. I'm not trying not to get too technical.
Well, I was just about to say, I'm going to have to pull you back to the table and the food so we can put this knowledge to use in a practical way. And you said a few things to me at the cooking class that I thought were very interesting. And, you know, I had said to you, do you have to do this all at once? Do you have to change to I remember once going on a diet in college, and it was mostly of cruciferous vegetables. Not a good plan, because you know you get very bloated and very uncomfortable. So maybe a little bit of moderation is in order. What do you tell your patients?
So I help them transition. Number one, I tell them for the first week, why don't you try to do at least one plant-based meal a day? And then I try to phase out the things that are the most harmful, like cured meats or with preservatives and, you know, anything coming from the deli department and dairy.
Yes, you told me that going to the deli and to the dairy case were the two worst things that you could do.
Exactly.
Does that include dairy alternatives like cashew milk or soy milk?
No, it has to do with cow's milk and animal protein. So the animal proteins, they have a special amino acid that has been shown to cause a lot of oxidative stress to your body and damage.
I see. So is that, I should ask you on the way, because I know a lot of people are using lactose-free milk. Does using lactose-free milk get rid of that?
No, because it's getting rid of lactose with its sugar, not a protein.
I see. And how about the A1, A2? Talk about the new milks that remove one of the proteins?
So those are what they talk about, you know, modifying the makeup of the milk and so on. So they basically want you to keep buying the same product, just a little bit more expensive because it doesn't have, quote unquote, the harmful thing. There are just better ways. You're better off just avoiding the offending agent.
Okay.
I haven't seen studies saying that that kind of milk produces good outcomes.
It's pretty new as well. So,
yes.
All right. So we're out of the dairy case. We're just pretty much avoiding it, except for now. Do you have a preference on, you know, soy milk or cashew milk or?
So, based on what I study on the medical literature, I tend to favor the soy products, and if you can make your own milks, it's best. But if you don't have the time, try to buy the ones that said organic. And soy almond will be my top because they tend to have the least calories and the least fat.
And basically, if you're going to make your own milk without a cow to help, you're going to do what? I think I've seen cashew milk made, but
yes,
tell us how you do that.
And I'll share with you resources that you can find that, you know, we're not going to reinvent the wheel, but if you have a smartphone or a computer, you can go on Pinterest and you can get
a
gazillion recipes on this.
Right.
That will certainly be helpful. Other resources that I use with patients when they're transitioning is like the forks over knives,
mm-hmm.
and they have recipes in.
This is a magazine and a movement, which is pushing the idea of a plant-based diet, both for your health and I believe also for the environment.
Right. All started with a documentary they did based on medical studies that is pretty powerful on the presentation of the results, and it talks about the China study and the researchers here in the U.S. that have found this. So.
Okay, I wanted to point out, because you pointed this out to me, that you're approaching this as part of an overall healthcare. You're not only looking at holistic methods or eating methods. You're like a regular doctor,
right? And you know, if I'm able to get away from prescribing medications, it's even better. But if you need a medication, I will certainly,
do that. So you're kind of doing a little East and West and mixing it up here. So I think because we have all this lovely food to look at, we should talk a little bit about, is there anything on this table that you wouldn't recommend as part of a plant-based diet?
No, I would recommend everything is good.
Okay.
I will say yes. And, you know, some of the things that we have here, there's a famous physician who is a pioneer when it comes to research in nutrition. His name is Dr. Michael Greger. And he has a website that I encourage you to look it up. It's called nutritionfacts.org. And you can look at the properties of each one of these vegetables. But for example, the tomatoes, they have the lycopene that makes them red. And those are very important for your eye health.
Mm-hmm.
However, the absorption is not that great. Normally, we need a special aid here, which comes from the avocados, and they give you the fat to absorb it. And so when you mix this and spinach, you're basically getting the ingredients of the IRAT vitamin, which is for macular degeneration.
Oh, interesting.
And this is very interesting in preventing the disease. So I strongly suggest that you eat this frequently.
I was just going to say that I believe that your practice has a Facebook group called Healthy to Conquer on Facebook, and people share recipes there, and
yes.
And your staff puts up some information to help your patients when they're making this transition. So there is beyond, you know, we've all heard you eat rice and beans together for protein. Is that true?
So there's a lot of chatter and noise about protein. The fact is, medical studies have shown that when you decrease the amount of protein in your diet without causing starvation, people live longer.
Hmm.
And it's not necessarily that all proteins across the board. It's just the proteins that have leucine in it.
Is that the complex proteins?
Those are the proteins that most proteins will have that, but the higher concentration of that amino acid leucine comes from animal sources.
Uh-huh. So that would, of course, bring us back to plant-based eating.
Right.
And from what you're saying, too, there are things that might be kind of hiding out, like butter, and then most margarines are not so great for you for other reasons.
Just because it's plant-based is not necessarily great.
Right. You want to look at the trans fats, right?
Right.
But if someone wanted, what is an easy meal? You made a couple of things when we were at that class, but
yes.
Can you give me an example of, tell me what you have for breakfast.
So for breakfast this morning, we had God bless my wife. She made a homemade bread, hazelnut bread, and she has a bread machine. So she puts the ingredients in it, and she told me that it had whole wheat flour, almond flour, we just crushed almonds, mm-hmm. and flaxseed, mm-hmm. ground flaxseed. It has the compounds that fight cancer and omega-3s and so on. And with that, we toasted the slices and we put a little bit of homemade peanut butter, which is just put the peanut butter in the food, the peanuts in the food processor, and mm-hmm. And then you spread it, and then on top some apricots, and which I roasted no mm-hmm. oil on a pan, along with strawberries and a little bit of date syrup. If you don't have date syrup, you can just use the fresh dates, because this is made out of just dates. There's nothing else right. in it.
And it adds a lot of sweetness to whatever you're making.
Right.
It that doesn't sound too complicated once you get used to it. And do you bring your lunch to work?
So I always bring my lunch to work. Yes, it's always plant-based. I basically have for lunch leftovers from the night before.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes, you know, if the food was so good, we didn't have leftovers. Yeah. So I usually have, we cook in batches and we have things in the freezer. So I just take out some falafel and hummus. Mm. And
I was telling you that when I'm in a hurry, I don't want to advertise for any particular store, but you can get your hummus and falafel in a little package to bring if you don't have time to make your own.
Right.
So it doesn't have to be totally intimidating. And the other thing I had asked you is, as you're starting this, if you're visiting someone or you happen to run into like the best steak you ever tasted, if you go back and have a meal that is not plant-based, does that negate what you've been doing, or do you expect that you would not feel so well, or what's?
Well, if you eat out and do this every day, you probably won't get the benefits of plant-based
right.
nutrition.
Say once a week, like the food reviewer.
I'm pretty active in the ministry, and sometimes I'm, invited to eat over. And if that happens, I don't even ask what they put in it. I just mm-hmm. eat it. Now, that usually happens, once a quarter. It's not that often. So I don't see any effects. Now, there are studies about that, and the frequency of being omnivorous, meaning that you eat all kinds of sources, mm-hmm. right, is inversely related to the health benefits.
Okay, so when you eventually transition yourself to a plant-based diet, pretty good idea to stay there, although you don't have to make a big fuss if you're in public someplace. So I am.
And that all depends on your goals. See, I tailor everything to the patient's goals. This
oh,
is not
I see.
About me. And if in your case, this is a part of your life, and this is something important for you,
mm-hmm.
I will just concentrate on making sure that you make choices that are less harmful among the ones you have to make and still keep you doing what you like.
And in terms of complex proteins, generally speaking, do you find fish are less harmful than
beef? So I just find, I will significantly try to decrease the amount of saturated fat you get
right.
from animal sources as much as possible.
Yep, and that certainly isn't news. But so we have all these wonderful things to start with, and this is just the things that I know how to cook. There were a few things at Stop and Shop that like yucca and jackfruit, and that I just had absolutely no idea on. So if any of you out there are using those products on a regular basis, give me a call, because perhaps you could give me a lesson in some of the lesser known but now widely available produce from other countries, because we want to show you how to make something. Before we do, two of my favorites, eggplant goes well in a lot of things. Good for us, yes?
Yes, absolutely.
And
great.
This is, a lot of people are not familiar with this squash, but it's very summery tasting. You can pierce it and cook it in the microwave, or you can bake it, and then you cut it in half, and you use a fork to literally just take the inside out, and it's called spaghetti squash because put a little sauce on there, and it does, well, pretty much taste like spaghetti.
It does very well.
Anyway, yes. So that's enough with other things, but you brought this, and you want me to use it. So tell me what we're going to do.
So we're going to make a plant-based gelato. It's a happy ending in the summer. We came up with this dish, and it's actually quite good. So go ahead and open that up. And what I do is for every two people, I use one banana, which I slice, put in a Ziploc, and then I freeze it. So okay. We're going to put some of the...
You know, I've never used this before. And when this happened to Julia Child, she actually threw it out. But I won't throw your blender out.
There you go. Thank you. So put some of maybe that piece of the frozen banana in.
Okay. How many pieces?
Well, just this chunk. Okay. As you can see, it's accurately measured.
I don't have gloves. You should have told me I'd be cooking. But since it's just for us, I might use my clean hands.
Okay.
There you go. Yep. I don't know that you know this, but I'm known for my clumsiness. I have this thing here.
Yeah, you have that.
Can get this down. Right. Just one piece
and
like that.
And we're going to put some, I buy the frozen strawberries for this.
Oh, okay.
But you can use some
blueberries.
Fresh ones too, if you want.
Okay. So these are blueberries, but you can also use strawberries or whatever you want.
Any berries, and there are different variations.
How am I doing? More? Less?
Well, we can try it, and then we'll add more if we need to. And I add nuts for protein, and it makes it creamy. And so we can add almonds. We can do pistachios, pecans, cashews. So what would you like?
Well, it was interesting. I think you said that the cashews are best because they're creamiest, but not if you have gout. Because is that, do I have
If you eat too many of the cashews, you can get a spike in uric acid.
Okay, which aggravates your gout, which is what causes that, right? Okay, so you want to keep that in mind. What if we mixed a couple?
Absolutely.
So,
go ahead.
I know I was reading that almonds have a phenomenal amount of protein.
Yes.
So, all right. I should have practiced.
And as you're opening that, I'm just going to share with people, because we tend not to eat those as much, but the legumes, what we call beans, they're linked to longevity. The more you eat, the longer you live healthier.
Does it matter if they're cannellini with the white beans or the red kidney beans?
So, The five top beans with the most amount of antioxidants are lentils. Then is the small kidney beans, the large ones, the black beans, and the chickpeas. Actually, chickpeas are garbanzo beans. They're number two.
Yeah.
So that's where we get the hummus and so on. So those will certainly, you will get the most bang out of your buck, but you can have any beans you like.
And what if you're trying to, you said you lost weight when you started eating this way.
Right. And before, I mean, before I started to do this, I always had a normal weight with a BMI around 24.5, normal being up to 25. And when I changed to plant-based, my weight went down about 15 pounds. But what I did notice was that my exercise endurance went down, and I talked to Dr. Siddharth, and he pointed out that I was not eating the right way for the amount of exercising I was doing, and he corrected that, and, you know, I have great endurance.
Did you need more protein?
It wasn't more protein, so I needed more calories.
Oh, I see. Interesting. Okay, because these foods tend to have less calories. You know, when you're staying away from the creamy sauces and the steak and all that, there tends to be less calories. But you still need to get the right blend. So I guess people would, is there anything else going in here?
Yes.
Okay.
I think you need to add, because it's frozen, you need to add about a tablespoon or two of water.
Okay.
And
maybe a little bit more. How's that look?
Okay.
Okay.
And let's run it.
All right. Which we would do how? Does this click in or?
And then you have to slide it. There you go. Good.
Okay. I'm blender challenged. Are we going for chop or grind on this?
Let's do grind and see what happens.
Okay. Okay, here we go. Ready? It's going to be noisy, guys. Do I keep pulling?
Yeah, keep pulling.
I put a lot of blueberries in.
Okay. Let's hold it for a second. Let's You can add the date syrup, and if you don't have date syrup, you can just do plain dates.
Yeah.
And I normally, but I forgot to bring it, I apologize, is a tablespoon of vanilla extract.
Oh, okay. That's okay. We can do that. Here, help me.
Okay, pull it up.
Okay.
And
it seems a little bit loose. Is there something we need to do to tighten it up?
We're going to in a second.
Oh, okay. How much did you say?
About a tablespoon.
Okay, maybe once more then. This is going to be like my telling people, oh, it's about 3 miles when it's like 15. Although I do cook from feel. I've just never made this before.
No, I brought blueberries because blueberries, they have a great effect with their antioxidant properties on your brain, on your mood. Oh. They prevent cognitive decline and improves depression.
Huh, how about that? That's it. I like blueberries, raspberries, blackberries, but it's blueberries that do that?
All the berries do that, but the blueberries have a significant amount of those compounds.
So we should be eating blueberries like every day?
At the very least, twice a week.
Oh, okay.
Serving. If you have those conditions, you might want to consider eating them more frequently.
And does it matter if food is cooked or raw?
So sometimes when we cook food, we lose some of the ingredients, like in the water, if you're doing beans and so on. But you certainly get more than not eating them at all, so go ahead and cook them.
Oh, okay. So, you know, because blueberry sauce is very nice, you know.
Yes.
Put a little bit of the date stuff in to sweeten it.
Let me take a look.
Okay.
And see how we're looking.
Probably need this.
Yeah.
Here we go. I'll do it.
I see it. You can do it. See how
it's coming along. Let's see if they can see it on the camera. It's getting thicker and kind of like a loose soft serve right now.
Right. Usually we like it a little bit thicker, so don't be too shy with the blueberries. Not gonna hurt you.
It smells fantastic. It really smells good. All right. This is a nice way to get your blueberries. I usually have them with oatmeal. We haven't talked about oatmeal.
It's a great source of fiber, and I use it quite a bit, actually. Mm-hmm. And I'll give you a recipe for a yogurt substitute.
Because you don't do dairy.
No, I don't do any dairy.
I have had that cashew substitute and for yogurt. That's pretty good.
Yes.
So the problem is, I don't know how to let people try this over Facebook.
You have to take our word.
You'll have to take our word and make it yourself. We can.
It's very simple to make.
I was going to say, it doesn't seem to have a particular recipe. Only we tell you what to put in it, and then you can tell us how it tastes. So you're going to put a little bit in a cup here, and we're going to give this a try. Thank you. Get some for you. Get some for our producer, Jason. Right now or now? He's producing. Okay, here we go. So that's about the consistency, everybody, if you can see that. And here you go.
Thank you. So sometimes what we make is we make this whole grain thin pancakes. And then we put this on top as a happy ending.
Ooh, that sounds good. Or as a cool treat. Now, do you ever freeze this, or does it, if you freeze it?
You can freeze it, and I just put it in containers, individual ones, and I freeze it, and then we eat it, yes.
Oh, okay. Well, to healthy eating.
Cheers.
And thank you so much.
You're very
welcome.
People
will find you in Bourne, and I wanted to let you guys know that this is a doctor who walks once a month with his patients. He's walking the walk, and if you check that Facebook group, if you check the Cape Cod Healthcare website.
And the Facebook group, Healthy to Conquer, we post when the walking activity, and you do not need to be my patient. We only charge you a smile for admission.
That's right.
And I always stay with the slowest person.
Right, which was reassuring to me. Says you don't have to be competitive, or you don't have to be fast. You just have to be willing to meet on the canal usually, right, and take a walk with Dr. Prieto and his patients. And you can always talk about plant-based eating,
right,
while you're doing that. So we're going to do like Lydia Bastianich and, you know, eat. And you guys have a good week.
Thank you for having me.